supercharger back on, but he's killed it.
Yeah. Go, and the guy's bought it and he's picking up on Monday because it's already valeted. The thing goes and does this.
So I've got a gent wants to see the Ford Focus this morning, and typically that's right at the back, but I think that gives us a good opportunity to have a rejig. The Barchetta also needs to come out because the Barchetta needs to go down and get its cam belt done. So that needs to come out anyway. And the Doblo needs to go down and get its top mounts done. And I want to do a little bit of paint on the Vauxhall there. So, it's a good opportunity to rejig everything around. And obviously, because some of it's been sitting for a couple of weeks as well, could do with a bit of a dust off. So we'll get all this out, sweep the place back out again, and then rejig it all.
So, danger ride in a Fiat Barchetta. 10-year-old cam belt, or older than that, possibly. We've got to make it a mile down the road for its MOT and for its recon. I'm asking the guys to redo all the oil, do the cam belt, do the oil and filters, redo all the brake fluids, and then put it for an MOT. So we'll see how that goes. Just baby it along nice and steady. Not too far away now, about half a mile away.
Well, I forgot to video dropping the Barchetta off at, what guys did I drop it off to? I dropped it off to Motorworks. They're doing the Barchetta. I'm just picking up the MR2 from Moore's Garage. This, they re-MOT'd for me. I said, look, have a look over it. Have a look at the advisories that the person put all over the last one. Tell me what you're happy with, what you think needs doing. They had a look at it. They actually found a tyre that the other guy didn't advise, I don't think. So they've done the tyre for me. But other than that, they felt no need at all to note anything regarding the hubs having surface rust on them or the shocks. So they have redone me a ticket and it only notes the advisory for the tyre. So that makes the MR2 eminently more saleable than it was before. I think, judging by most of what you put in the comment, most of your MOT testers said you thought it was someone just young and inexperienced or someone that had the telling off recently and was going overboard. Now I've just got a horseshoe myself in it. My god, it's this small. The Barchetta felt bigger than this, and then I might drive it for the weekend, give it a good run and make sure that we iron out any bugs before we get it up for sale. I can barely get my arm in to get where the key goes. Probably not the best car for you guys if you are over 6 foot and you like a pasty or two. Right, let's go. I'm definitely going to drive that the weekend. I only just came back from Moors. I haven't gone very far. And I hadn't pushed it before because obviously it had been sitting for ages. We hadn't done the service yet. We hadn't done the brakes. Hadn't had an MOT to check if there's any safety issues. But now that all that's been done, I thought I could give it a bit of beans. Did a little bit of a run around the back there. Oh my goodness, that's a lot of fun. I've never driven one before. That is a lot of fun. I think that's pretty on a par with an MX-5, you know. Petey's done a beautiful job on the brakes. It stops on its nose. If you remember, we had him completely flush all the old fluid out, put new fluid in, strip the calipers down, clean it all up, put new brake pads in, and I think we put some discs on as well. I can't remember if we put discs on. Or is it? Yeah, we've got new discs on. It stops on its nose, but it loves to rev. Loves to rev and flipping it. It's a little limpet. Go around a roundabout on it. That's a lot of fun. I might have to flipping horseshoe myself in it and get Mrs. Chops to get a can opener at the other end. But that is a lot of fun. Our Focus has sold, but on the test drive, it threw up a TMS light, which initially I thought meant just one of the tyres was down a bit. But it says that the sensors are not detected. And this car needs picking up on Monday. So I don't really want to have to visit the garage. So we broke out the top don. Today we have the Artidag 900. And we've got that plugged in. It's saying body control, 2 faults. Anything else? That's it. It's clear other than that. So let's go into that and see what it's got to say about body control. Read trouble code. Vehicle must be prepared. Yeah, okay. These are so invaluable, guys, if you're flipping cars or looking to fix it. See, it's trying to horn itself there. These are so invaluable. You can see as it, everything will flick through there as it works its way through the systems. Yeah, they're so invaluable if you're flipping cars because you don't want to have to run down the garage every time a code comes up.
Right, so it's got an historical one for a tyre pressure sensor and a historical one for a rear fog lamp. I do wonder, the battery was very low on this when I pulled it out earlier today, and that can often throw up a number of things. I think the thing might be due to clear it and drive it around and see if it comes back again or not. But if we go into that tyre, see if it'll indicate which one it is. We can hit search. I don't know if I've connected this one to the internet. If it is connected to the internet, it will allow me to search up more specifics about that code. I don't want to sign in. Bloody reject all. There you go. So there we go. It connects to the internet and tells me, it says you've got to replace and reprogram a sensor if it won't clear there by the looks of it. So if it clears, the sensor's all right, but if it doesn't clear, it means it's going to need a new TPMS sensor, which means it will have to go down the garage for that. But so let's go back and clear the code. Well, let's try and clear the code and see what it does. Because I do say the battery was low, so it has cleared them okay. Historical. Still showing that as an historical code. Will it clear at all? Yeah, still showing that's a historical code. Let's start the car and see if the light will go out or not. Oh, actually, better still, let's turn the car off completely and turn the car back on again and see if the codes are there. No, it's coming back. So we've got a bad sensor. Sod's law, it's done that on the test drive. So I know what I need to order. At least thanks to the Top Don, I know what I need to order. I have heard tell that these can do multiples in one go, which would be a right pain in the bum, and I don't know how much the sensors actually are. So just when you think it's simple, you've got a car all MOT'd and serviced and all ready to go, and the guy's bought and he's picking up on Monday because it's already valeted, the thing goes and does this. What a pain in the bum. Just a quick reminder, if you're not doing as many cars as I am and you just want a code reader for your own vehicles at home, Top Don do offer the Top Scan, which is a fantastic little Bluetooth device that you can plug into your car, read codes. But the big thing with this is it's bi-directional. Now, what that means is, unlike other cheaper scanners, it can not only receive information from the car, you can send information to the car, so you can trigger things, components in the car to test them. That's what bi-directional means. Like I say, the cheap ones will just retrieve data from the car. The Top Scan, bi-directional, you can actually trigger components on the car to test them. And it is an absolute bargain. It's only £38.24 at the moment for one of these. So I'll put a link in the video description down below. So if you aren't, like say, you're not a full-blown car flipper like me, but you want a code read around for the sort of the vehicles you've got at home, avoid you having to go to the garage when some of the issues come up, read live data, like if you've got problems with the oxygen sensors, that kind of thing, then this is bang on for you. Like I say, I'll put a link in the description down below for the top scan from Top Don. Remember, this little bit of kit will do almost all the features of some of the more expensive machines that I show. You can do electronic parking brake resets on it. You can do DPF resets on it. And if you're doing your own oil changes on modern vehicles that have service light indicators, you can reset your service light indicators with it. So yeah, again, link in the video description down below. Petey's in the house. He has done an oil change on the MX-5, and you can hear he's no longer taffety. He's just really thinned out oil, made the hydraulics taffety. So we fitted a different breather on. We fitted a new cap on there as well, because the old cap, the rubber was really flat and was letting oil out. We've got something vibrating at the front there, but I think that's the airflow. So a bit more fettling before we get the supercharger back on, but he's killed it.
Yeah.
So Pete's fillings there would have made sense to you if you watch my videos regularly. It is the MX-5 powered MGB that he was working on there, trying to get it running right. So let's update you on the latest on this. So in the previous video, I'd put the supercharger on, run it through the airflow meter into the engine, which had caused massive overfueling because it had been holding the flap wide open on the AFM. It flushed fuel down the bores, thinned the oil out,
made the engine sound really tappety. So a bit more research turned out that on a 1.6, I needed the AFM pre-supercharger, hence why I've got some swirling piping over there ready for the AFM to go on there. But a little bit more research discovered that I could actually delete the AFM together, because they're renowned for being quite bad, by installing a... what is this? This is an air temp sensor, this one here. So the FM has air temp, air flow, and something else on it. The reason I can do away with air flow and just have air temp is because I have an ECU, which people have been begging me to get all along. I have an ME Motorsports electronic ECU here to go in. And this is pre-set up. I've already put it in the housing. Pre-set up. With a 1.6 map on it, but it has its own air flow sort of sensor in it, which is run off a vacuum pipe off there that runs up to the inlet manifold up here. So I run a pipe, I've already got it running into the car over here, but on there, so between the air temp sensor there and the air pressure there, it will give all the readings it needs. So I say this has got a 1.6 base map on it, but I can download a map to it for other 1.6s that have got superchargers on them. Now, before I do that, everyone that has a supercharger on it has RX-8 injectors in. So they take Mazda RX-8 injectors and put them in to give it enough fuel going in, and a fuel pressure regulator, which I've got as well. So here's the adapter that goes into the old AFM plug and just goes to the air, to just the temperature there. And so we'll plug that in. I've got the different filter there, as I said earlier. So then we'll plug in the new ECU. We'll put in the RX-8 injectors. And we'll put in a fuel pressure regulator. Then I won't have to put anything here other than an air filter, because I won't have to fit the air flow meter anymore. So I'll just be able to put the air filter up here. So do away with a load of this piping. Because I managed to get it fitting inside the inner wing before. Excuse me. So I'm just waiting on the RX-8 injectors, because I cheaped out and bought ones off eBay, and then rang the guys asking that sold me the ECU, asking for their advice on how to set this up. And they said, you haven't bought the RX-8 injectors off eBay? I said, yes. They said, no, you need to get genuine Denso ones, otherwise you'll have all kinds of problems doing it. So we'll get them installed, and then we'll download the new map, and then we'll see where we are, because I'm determined to try and do this as much as possible myself. Because I could send it off and get it all set up, but then if I have any problems with it, I won't know how to resolve them. I think final fettling, yes, will be rolling roadie, but I want to understand the basic setup and get that right. Like I say, if I can do away with that, I might even be able to squeeze an intercooler in here as well. The scary thing is, speaking to the guys that provided me with the ECU, they were saying that, I'm just putting this on here in case I lean something on it, I don't want to squish any of the pins. They were saying that with the setup I'm talking about having, they reckon it could be running at 240 brake horsepower, which is pretty damn terrifying in an MGB, which still has leaf springs and lever arms at the front. I don't want that much horsepower. To be honest, I'd be happy with about 150 horsepower. It'd be just enough to have fun. You might notice the nose cone is off the Firebird, and that's because my daughter has her prom coming up. She's done her final exams and wants to go in the Firebird, and wants to paint it with me before we go, which leaves us not a lot of time at all. So she's going to come in tomorrow, and we're going to start stripping it down and painting it. Luckily, it comes apart like a Meccano set. I'll get these vents off in a bit. So the nose cone is off, so we can tidy that up and paint that. We will just be going really, really simple with an all-in-one 2K gloss black, so I can flat it back, paint it. We won't do separate lacquer, and... we'll just be tidying up. I'm not going to be going for perfection. I'm not going to be sort of block sanding the whole thing and making sure it's arrow straight down the sides. We're just going to get rid of all this bubbling and flaking bits and probably paint it panel by panel in sections. And just, like I say, get rid of all this bubbling stuff here. I've got to put the rubbers in the door and sort that out up there, all that kind of stuff. And just buzz, let's say, just buzz over the top of that. Then backmaster sort of here, paint that, and then do it section by section, because I don't think we're going to be able to do it all in one go, not in the space I've got. The weather's getting better now, and as you can see, all my stuff is, all my nice older stuff that's to be driven when the sun out, is piled with crap on top of it and not running properly at the moment. Actually, that does run all right. That needs to be pulled out
and used a bit. But yeah, I need to get all this out and have a rejig and a tidy up. But just a bit of pressure on me, like I say, to get the Firebird done now. And I really want this up and running properly. Speaking of lovely old cars out in the sunshine, don't forget the Mercedes CL500 raffle is still going. It has hit its minimum sales target, so it will be won by somebody. This car will be won. It's got a brand new MOT on it. It's got 95,000 miles, which isn't a lot for 2003 at all, is it? In fantastic condition. It is a really cool car. Drives lovely. You've got the 5-litre V8 in it. The interior is locked. Keyless entry, look at that, from 2003. Interior is fantastic condition throughout. It's got electric, absolutely everything on it. Really is an incredible car. I think, what did we find out this was? 70-odd thousand pounds brand new, or was it more than that? Yeah, everything is electric. It's in incredible condition. Just £2 per ticket, with a portion of the proceeds going to Ability FC. That is the football club in Barnstable that is run for those with special needs and learning disabilities. You do have the option of choosing £4,000 cash if for some unknown reason you don't want this fantastic car. I'll put a link in the video description down below, and look for special offers we've got on ticket sales at the moment. I'll put those on screen now. But hurry, we haven't got long left to run on this, and I say someone will be guaranteed to win this or the £4,000 cash.